don't think my mic's on, so we're... Oh, there it is. You guys feeling good this morning? All right. Well, you know what? Some of us were up at the 8:15 service. I like you slackers who are now here at the 11 o'clock service. Well, no matter what, let's worship the Lord, huh?
We bring a sacrifice of praise unto the house of the Lord. We bring a sacrifice of praise unto the house of the Lord. And we offer up to you the sacrifices of thanksgiving. And we offer up to you the sacrifices of joy. And we bring the sacrifice of praise unto the house of the Lord. We bring the sacrifice of praise unto the house of the Lord. And we offer up to you the sacrifices of thanksgiving. And we offer up to you the sacrifices of joy.
Sing, oh God.
Oh God, you are my God, and I will ever praise you. Oh God, you are my God, and I will ever praise you. I will seek you in the morning, and I will learn to walk in your ways, and step by step you lead me. And I will follow you all of my days. Oh God, you are my God, and I will ever praise you. Oh God, you are my God, and I will ever praise you. I will seek you in the morning, and I will learn to walk in your ways, and step by step you lead me, and I will follow you all of my days. And step by step you lead me, and I will follow you all of my
One of the great things about that song is it says, I will seek you in the morning. And some of us are a little early rising, and some of us are not. But it's still morning. Saying, who has the power?
Who has the power the dead? Who can save us from our sin? He is our hope, our righteousness. It's Jesus, only Jesus.
Who can make
the blind to see? Set us free. He paid it all to bring us peace. It's Jesus, only Jesus. He's holy, King Almighty, Lord. Saints and angels all adore. Join with him and bow before Jesus. has the name above all names. You stand alone, I stand amazed.
Yes,
Jesus, only Jesus.
He's holy,
King Almighty, Lord. Saints and angels all adore and join with them and bow before Jesus, only Jesus.
You will command the highest praise. Yours is the name above all names. You stand alone, I stand amazed. Jesus, only Jesus.
Yes, Jesus, only Jesus.
The Holy King Almighty, Lord.
Saints and angels all adore, join with them and bow before Jesus, only Jesus.
The Holy King Almighty, Lord.
Saints and angels all adore, join with them and bow before Jesus, only Jesus.
Yes, Jesus, only Jesus.
Amen. Hallelujah. Father, we thank you. We thank you for who you are. We thank you, Jesus, that you allow us to come before you and bow before you. You are so deserving of our worship and our praise. We honor you this morning. Be glorified in our midst. Be glorified in our lives. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Amen. Why don't you turn to someone, welcome them. If you haven't seen their face in a while, give them a little pinch on the cheek. Facial cheek. Be more specific. How are you?
Good. How are you?
I'm tired.
I know.
Been up for a while. She's a hoarder.
Chipmunks.
Yeah. All right. All right. All right, so we have a lot of people back from a while. Man, I thought you were raptured. I thought you were raptured. Yeah, good. He's like, I'm not going before you all. All right, well, I got some people back. That's great. Everyone doing well? It's been a good week. Man, our temperature's dropped pretty good. Yeah, it's starting to get that good weather. Yeah. And you know, this is the thing. There are so many people that are still up in the snow. They're nuts. Yeah. We got this beautiful white stuff, too. It's called sand. You know? Yeah. Well, so birthdays. Anyone celebrate a birthday this past week that we can celebrate with you? No? Man, this is going to be easy. How about anniversaries? No anniversaries? No? All right, we're moving fast. Good, because it's a long sermon. All right. So a couple things. Jim's going to come up, so ladies, you don't have to worry about. I told them they were the ones that had to get us on all the same key. So, a couple things. Restrooms, if this is your first time here, your first time back, our restrooms are being renovated right now because we had a leak underneath the concrete that kind of made us do this. And so it was supposed to start right after Easter. Obviously, that did not happen because if you go over there, do not use the restrooms. Okay? There are none. Okay? But they finally... there's not even a door, so you just be embarrassed. Okay? So, thanks, Jim, for bringing that up. So all that's left to do now is we're going to stain the concrete because we're trying to cut down costs. So, concrete needs to be stained. They're going to just put up 4 foot of tile to make it easier to clean. And then just paint and then all the amenities. So, the things you need. And so, just to give you a heads up, though, ladies, they have switched the bathrooms, okay? So now yours is now the closest one to this door, okay? So I know that what's going to happen is one Sunday, I'm going to hear a, you know. So just to let you know, men, yours is the furthest one now, okay? Just to give a heads up. But if you need to use the restroom, you need to go, what's up? So you need to go, if you need to use the restroom, you can go through these two doors, through that door, through those two doors, through one more door that says office, and it's over on the other side of the other building. Okay, did you all get that? There's always a line, but we had a generous gift that there is now a porta potty out there. So if you want to skip the line and just go use the porta potty, there you go. There's that too. So we thank the couple that allowed us to use that. So hopefully in the next 2 weeks it will be done right before Thanksgiving. So perfect timing.
Yep.
The other two things real quick is we have teaching. Sunday nights, it's going to be a little different than it has been in the past. We're going to do once a month or once a sermon series. We're going to do a sermon discussion to talk about all the sermons in that thing that we've done in the past. But on Sunday nights at 6 o'clock, it'll be a teaching on... the series is called There is an I in Church, meaning that we all have a responsibility in the Church of God, and so we're talking about what that is. Because when we don't do our responsibility in the Church of God, the church actually suffers because of that. So we need to know our role and what we can do to help out our brothers and sisters. And so that's the whole series. We just spent, I think it's 3 weeks, talking about just what the church is. And now we're starting to talk about our roles in the church. So that would be tonight and the next few weeks. On Wednesdays, though, we're going to start our apologetics series, our apologetics teaching on Wednesday nights at 6 p.m. And what that is, if you don't know what apologetics is, it's not apologizing. Okay? The word apologia means to give a defense. All right? So we teach you how to give a defense for your faith. And so this year's teaching is on world religions and world views. So we're going to go over the major worldviews and the major world religions and talk about their history, what they believe, how they look like Christianity, how they don't look like Christianity, and how you can share the gospel with someone of that faith. All right, so that's Wednesdays at 6 p.m. All right, and then the last thing I have is, I got a text. Our piano player is actually sick today, so if you could be playing for Linda. But she wanted me, I think she just was trying to dodge this announcement. That's what I think it was. But she is doing the choir for our Christmas play this year, and she wants to have the first practice on Sunday, November 26th of this month. That'll be the first choir practice after this service. Okay, so right after the service, they're going to have the first choir practice and go over all the music. All right, yeah. Yes, questions? Yes, yes. No, they're doing the play. All right. I think that's it. Jim's on. Jim.
Hi, everybody. Welcome to Alliance Church. Glad you're here. Are you happy to be here?
Yes.
Did you bring the Lord with you?
Amen.
No, he didn't. He brought you. He takes care of everything. So anyway, first time back. I know we have two in particular. There's more. If you're here for the first time, back for the first time this year, please stand up. All we want to know is your name and where you're from and your driver's license. There we go. There's brave ones. Okay. Let's start over here. Yes, sir.
Oh, sure. Well, I have to say, as I'm walking into the parking lot, first time to come here, I've known this sweet lady for umpteen zillion years. We've been to Israel together.
Oh, boy.
We used to be in the same town in Washington State, anyway.
Whereabouts?
I used to live in Cooley Dam, Washington.
Cooley, where's that?
Oh,
Cooley Dam. Oh.
South Columbia.
Oh, yes. Lake Roosevelt.
Uh-huh.
Oh, yeah. Well, welcome.
Anyway, I'm David. This is Debbie Spencer. And
yeah.
I live in Ephrata, Washington.
Good for you. I'll back up what you said about her being a sweet lady, too. And you, sir, and ma'am.
Scott and Nancy, and we're from Missoula, Montana.
Missoula, Montana. Thank you. Jim. Grand Coulee, Washington. Good. Okay, and here we have?
Terry and Esther Williams. We're from British Columbia. We moved to British Columbia from Alberta. And in the Okanagan. And now we're here. Thank the Lord.
Good. Good to have you. Now you just got to make one more step and get down to U.S.
Yes.
Never mind. And back here we have? Minnesota. Yeah, welcome. Again, glad to have you back. That's it. Okay, I'm going to sit down for a fall. Okay, announcements are what he said about the evening tonight. There's evening teaching and on Wednesdays. Be sure to catch those. I haven't attended the apologetics in a long time, but they are fascinating to me, so I'm going to try and make it all this time. So, okay, Monday, nothing's open here. Don't even come around. Drive through the parking lot if you want to. Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, and Friday, office hours are from 9 a.m. to 12 p.m. till noon. So if you need anything or talk to Jeremiah, come in at those times. That's Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, and Friday. On Tuesdays, the tops meet in the fellowship hall at 9 a.m. to 12 p.m. And then on Thursdays, the ladies' quilting outfit, they meet at 9 a.m. to 2 p.m. in the fellowship hall also.
Tops meet at 7.
So, oh, I read the one above at 9 a.m. That's office hours. Don't come during office hours. Ruth, I'm trying to get fired, but he won't listen. He won't take the hint. starting all over again. Okay, you're from where? No, just kidding. Tops, on Tuesday, Tops meet at 7 a.m. For how long? That's not on here. Till everybody gets, okay. Alrighty, well, good deal. Thank you for straightening me out. Somebody's got to. Okay, that's the size of that. Let's pray. Father in heaven, we do thank you for your love. Father, we thank you for being such a wonderful God. Father, we thank you for your mercies, for your, especially for your grace. We thank you, Father, that you love us so much that you have sacrificed, made that ultimate sacrifice that the Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, died on the cross for each and every one of us that believe in the death, burial, and resurrection. We have eternal life. You saved us, Lord, from that destination, which Jeremiah is going to be preaching about here in just a little bit. Father, just pray that you would open his heart, teach us new and wonderful things, and open our hearts too, that we can receive them with understanding and with blessings. Thank you, Father. In Jesus' name we pray it. Amen.
Amen. All right. So for those of you guys that are back, we go through the summer and we do a book of Judges. And this particular summer we do a book and then we just finish off Judges. And you got to say, that is one of those books you're just glad to be done with. Because it's just a hard book to get through. But we're finally done with it. And so now we're starting into our fall series, which is an apologetic series. So I believe that apologetics is one of the most important things that us as believers can participate in, because we are called to share the gospel with whoever God brings into our lives. Like, that is our job, okay? Matthew 28, go into all the world. Acts 1:8, you will be my witnesses, okay? So we are supposed to share the gospel with whoever will listen, and even if they won't listen. All right, that is our job. And apologetics is specifically for what happens when someone has a question.
They go to Jeremiah.
Yeah, see, that's no joke. That is a default thing for a lot of Christians. They'll say, well, let me have you talked with my pastor. It's like, no. You are a minister of the gospel. All right? So my job as a pastor is to equip the saints. That's my job. Like, I'm not here to wipe your noses. All right? I'm here to equip you to do the work that Christ has called you to. One of those things, that's why we do apologetics. Okay? So every fall we do an apologetics series, and we tackle questions that you will possibly hear in the world. That's why we do the apologetics on Wednesday night, so you can be prepared as you encounter people. And sometimes, so we're going through worldviews and world religions on Wednesday nights. What happens is when I have conversations with people and I'm listening, because the best part of apologetics is to have open ears, to understand what a person is saying, is as soon as they start talking, the words they use and the phrases they use, I can go, oh, so you believe, even before they tell me, you believe this. Or you fall into a category of this. Because I understand, I've learned, I've studied, I've done this, so I can better understand what someone says and then say, this is what the gospel says. You can actually see that in the book of Acts. If you're reading through the book of Acts and you follow Paul, in this very brief span, I believe it's Acts 15 to Acts 17, you get two sermons by Paul. One is to the Jews. And you know where he starts out with talking to the Jews to begin with? He starts out with Abraham. Why? Because the Jews know Abraham. And they can connect on that level. In chapter 17, though, he goes in and he's talking to the Greeks. You know where he starts with the Greeks? Creation. We all have creation in common. They wouldn't know Abraham. They have no clue. That's apologetics. Understanding people and be able to share the gospel to their specific need. All right? So that's what we're doing. And so what we're doing is we're going to call this series TikTok Theology. Anyone know who TikTok or what TikTok is? A few people. There's some going both ways. Right? Yes and no. Okay, well, just to let you know, TikTok is a social media platform where you can share short-form videos. Okay? So there are the main... yes, you can talk about the Chinese own it, yeah. But out of the top 10 most popular social media platforms, five of them create or give an opportunity to create these short-form videos. Together, these reach about 10 million people a month. Okay? So about 10 million people a month have access to these short-form videos. So we can put that up there. So people are getting their information through these short-form videos. We can put it up there. It's fine. Oh, no, no, no. Oh, sorry. No, oh, go back. We're too far ahead now. Look at me getting far ahead. Anyways, do not look behind the curtain. All right. See, the older people get that. That's a Wizard of Oz reference, just to let you guys know. So about 10 million people a month have access to these social media sites. I mean, there's more than that, but these top five that do these short-form videos. And these go from anywhere from between 30 seconds to a minute. So if you're just looking on, if you go to YouTube, they call them Reels. On Facebook, I think they call them Shorts. So they have different lingo for these different things. But if you're on one of those social media sites, you have seen these. You're just scrolling along. So here's mine. And I'm just scrolling. I'm on Facebook here. And I'm just scrolling along. And there's my aunt. And she is at church. So that's cool. And then all these people. Hey, there's us right there. That's cool. Oh, my goodness. It's Inception. I'm right there. Anyways, sorry. That's trippy. So you just keep going down. And eventually, now it's not going to do it for me. Good job, Jeremiah. Anyways, let's go to YouTube. First thing, okay? So first thing, it just shows up as a short, okay? So these videos are designed for one purpose. It's to hook you into just watching videos, these things that go fast and fast and fast. Because you're watching... All of a sudden, you start scrolling. You go, oh, it's a funny dog and cat video. And you start looking at it, and then it stops 30 seconds in, gives you another one. And then it gives you another one. And you're there for an hour. And that's the purpose, is to keep you on the platform. And so these short-form videos are good in the sense of you get information. They're good in the sense they keep you on their platform. And they give you those good endorphins, right? The, ooh, man, this is, because you're accomplishing things, but it keeps you there, and that's their goal, is to keep you locked into what they want. What I have found in the last several years is that as I'm talking to people, this is where, these short-form videos is where a lot of people are getting their theology, or their thoughts on God, or their thoughts on history. And in one short video, it can create a whole theology for someone that takes me 30 minutes to fix. Because it can get so ingrained. And that's what this series is for. I want to give you resources and my approach on how when someone brings up something from a TikTok theologian, I go, this is how we unpack that. All right? So that's what we're going to do. I'm going to show you a video. And then there are going to be different people through different worldviews, different approaches to life throughout the next 4 weeks. And the purpose of this is not to denigrate them or to make fun of them or any of that. It's to help us understand what is out there and how to speak to it as believers. Okay? So we're going to listen to this video. It's about 59 seconds, and then we'll unpack the whole thing. All right? Ready? Oh, should I say this first?
Yeah.
Oh, okay. Because it's in your notes, right? Okay. So the person that we're going to be talking about today, he goes by the persona Jigesus. It's the gay Jesus. And what it is, he believes he kind of looks like Da Vinci's Jesus, and he's gay, so he puts the two together. It's his persona. And in fact, he says this is a character he plays, but he does identify as non-binary and gay. He says that he grew up in a Christian church, an evangelical church, and that through that he was traumatized. And then he deconstructed his faith. We, a few years ago, went through and talked about what deconstruction was. Basically, it's someone who grew up in the church. I wouldn't say necessarily had a saving faith, but they grew up in the church, and they believed they have a faith because it was impressed upon them. And then as they got older, they started asking questions, and they moved away from biblical Christianity into their own interpretation of the Bible. And some of that is a complete rejection of the Bible, and some of it is just a change. And we can kind of see in this particular person, he's changing the interpretations to fit his own worldview. And so this is who we're talking about today, all right? So now can we do it?
2,000 years ago. There's nowhere in the Bible that says eternal conscious torment is a thing. We call it that because it has to be eternal. You have to know what's happening. There has to be torture. That's not a concept in the Bible. Hell is not a concept in the Bible. Closest you can get to anything sounding like eternal conscious torment would be the devil getting thrown into the lake of fire, chained for 1,000 years, tortured. That's not humans. The eternal torment part kind of comes from Dante's Inferno. The divine tragedy. It's not biblical, babe. Before you come running in here with verses that sound vaguely like, well, it says that you will perish. Or Matt 10:28, that you may burn and be destroyed. Those are all annihilationism. Also, any mention of hell in the English Bible is probably incorrectly translated from one of four words. There's either Hades, Gehenna, Sheol, and then Tartarus is used for the devil once. But it says hell. Not what we're talking about. There is no mention of human souls being tortured endlessly, nor of the devil being the one to oversee it. Period. Update from 2,000 years ago. There's nowhere in the Bible that says eternal conscious torment is a thing. We call it that because it has to be eternal.
Yeah, there you go. All right, so this particular video is dealing with hell. All right, so I want you to be as educated as possible as believers. All right, that is my desire for you, is to be as educated as possible. So you need to understand within the scholarly realm and the theological realm of people in colleges, there is a debate on what is hell. Okay? And there's basically three stances, okay? The first one is kind of the one that everyone pretty much believes in Christianity. Like if you're a part of a Orthodox church, this is the one you'll believe. It's people die, the righteous who accepted Jesus, who were made righteous through Jesus, go on to eternal life with God, okay, and bliss and peace and happiness, okay? That's eternal life. When we talk about eternal life, that's usually what we say, what we mean. The wicked, those who have rejected Christ, who have lived in their sin, they go to eternal punishment, eternally, and then into hell, into the lake of fire, okay? So that is the separation to eternal life with God, eternal life separated from God, right? So that's usually the Orthodox stance. Usually most churches that are Orthodox will teach that. The other side of it is something that he mentioned, and that's annihilism. Basically, when at the judgment seat of Christ, you are judged, the believers to eternal bliss, the wicked get judged, and their punishment is snapped out of existence, annihilated. Their souls, everything about them, gone. That's the other side. There's one in the middle that's kind of gaining ground now in theological circles, where it's a combination of both. You are punished for a certain amount of time for your particular sin, and then either, depending on the theologian, they'll say, you will either be presented with the gospel and choose to go into eternal life, or you'll be annihilated. So there's these three kind of debates going on, okay? Now, the question isn't, is that debate going on? The question is there any mention of conscious torment in the Bible? That's the thing that this particular person brought up, right? So I like to only deal with things people bring up until it goes to another area, right? Because if we just go and we're just having, have you ever had one of those conversations where you try to speak, but then something else is brought in, and then something else is brought in, and something else is brought in, and it's like, okay, let's first deal with one issue, and we can talk about every single other issue, but we have to start with one. The reason is because our thought process needs to be complete. The reason is because right now, when we do stuff like that, we are in 30-second mode, okay? We're in those video modes where it's, I only need 30 seconds. No, deep issues call for deep understanding, okay? So it's going to take us like 30 minutes just to unpack this 59-second video, okay? So it takes a lot. So what we're going to do, he brings up three claims, okay? So we're going to take each one of those claims in turn, and they're going to get smaller and smaller as we go, right? So claim one, right? No eternal conscious torment in the Bible. Now, what I also like to do is I like to take in whatever is being given to me. So this particular one, he brings up two verses, John 3:16 and Matthew 10:28. So why he says don't bring those up, because those are annihilation passages. Well, I'm of the opinion of, well, let's see, right? Anytime someone brings up scripture, let's read it, right? Let's see what it says. So let's look at John 3:16. Now, you might have heard this verse. It's kind of one of those obscure verses. But this is what it says. For God so loved the world that he gave his only son, that whoever believes in him should not perish but have eternal life. The word that's important there is perish. Okay? That's the important word there. That's what he said was the annihilation word. All right? So the word that's being used there is apolomi. And it means destruction. Okay? Now here's the thing. In English, a lot of our words have very strict definitions, right? A word means a word that means a word, right? There are some words that are kind of different, right? Like a buck. Like, what's a buck? A deer? Oh, see? Right there. Straight to the hunter, right? Buck is a deer. Or a buck is a? Money, right? Everyone else is like money. They're like, no, not the hunter. The hunter is... So we do have words that do have different meanings, but within languages like Hebrew and Greek, they can have a range of meanings. And this word means perish, it means destruction, it also means lost. Okay? I just want you to know that, because as we're talking, that's really important to understand, that words in Greek and Hebrew mean a lot of things. And you know how you know what it means, which interpretation to take? The context. We talked about context is king. That's how you know. So what do we need to do? We need to look at the context. Where is this word also used? Just so happens, Matthew 10:28. So let's look at Matthew 10:28. This is the other verse. And do not fear those who kill the body but cannot kill the soul. Rather fear him who can destroy both soul and body in hell. Guess what the word is? Destroy. Yeah. We're not there yet. It's destroy. So perish and destroy, though they're used a different word, right? Seems to be mean the same thing, right? Destruction, right? Okay. So where else is this word used? Well, you just keep reading Matthew. In Matthew, we have Matthew. Is this how we're going? Yep, this is how we're going. In Matthew 10:28, it's destroy. In Matthew 10:39, listen how this same word is used. Whoever finds his life will lose it, and whoever loses his life for my sake will find it. So it uses the lost language of that word. Let's keep reading in Matthew. Matthew 15:24. He answered, I was sent only to the lost sheep of Israel. Let's keep reading. In 16:25, Jesus reemphasizes Matthew 10:39, for whoever would save his life will lose it, but whoever loses his life for my sake will find it. So, this idea of what is destruction, now we have a concept of destruction, right? It's totaled, right? You get in an accident with your car, the car is destroyed. It's totaled. It's unusable, right? What is God's definition of destroyed? It's unusable. It's lost. We can see this through the scriptures. So in Genesis 2 and 3, God says to Adam, and Adam relays it to Eve, "Do not touch of the tree, or you will what? Surely die." Eve and Adam touch of the tree. What happens to them? They don't die, but now they are separated. They are lost. They're unusable. They're destroyed. This is the concept of what God has. So when Jesus, he talks, he goes and people are crying about a little girl who has died. And everyone's saying, "She's dead, she's dead, she's dead." Anyone remember this story?
But she's asleep.
But she is asleep. This is what Jesus said, she's asleep. His concept of death and the people's concept of death are very different. It's because we have different concepts than God does. Where we say destroyed, we mean like snuffed out. Where God sees destroyed, he sees unusable things that have been lost, but things that can be found again. So what does Jesus say? "I have come to seek the destroyed ones, the lost Israel, the lost sheep of Israel." If you lose your life, if it's destroyed to you, you will gain life. This is the concept of what destruction is in the Bible. Is this perishing. It's not annihilation, it's separation from God. This is what that is. And so, this word is used to help us comprehend that idea of it's lost. It's unusable. It's destroyed. It's gone. But if we continue down this and we continue to read in Matthew, this is why it's so important to read the Bible, not just read a verse and not make theology a verse. If we continue to read in Matthew, this is what Jesus says about that separation. In Matthew 25, verses 41 through 46, we're only going to look at 41 and 46 today. In 41, Jesus, it's at the end of a sermon where Jesus is talking about what's going to happen at the end. And this is at the very end of chapter 25. It's talking about judgment, that day of judgment. What's that going to look like? And in the very end, he's talking about these sheep and these goats. And he says this. This is what he's going to say on that day. Says to those goats, he says, "Depart from me, you cursed, into the eternal fire prepared for the devil and his angels." This is the eternal separation. Apart from Jesus, this is the end. Now you have to understand, if you read through Jesus, this is not something that makes Jesus happy. This is almost like a sad, when you're reading through this, this is a sad thing. And what's interesting, Matthew takes this and he's like, this is one of the last things Jesus said to us, and then straight to the cross. Why? Because it's only through the cross that people can be saved from that eternal separation. It's almost like Matthew's like, this is how it's going. The Holy Spirit's saying, if you don't accept the cross, that's your destiny. And so he says that. And notice what it was prepared for. It wasn't prepared for humans. It was designed for the devil and his angels. That was God's design for that specific rebellion. But anyone who goes with that rebellion, Adam and Eve did, every human that involves himself in sin does, they go to the same place. A place the devil has no authority in. It's his pit that he goes into and he is stuck as a criminal. But that's where every human goes. And so this idea where he says the devil runs it, no. That's not in the Bible. But this anguish is. In 46, this is the last verse of chapter 25, and these will go away into eternal punishment, but the righteous into eternal life. Is that clear? Like, is the concept of eternal punishment in the Bible? It is. And it's something, start reading through the scriptures, it's what breaks God's heart. It's the thing, I mean, think about this. This is how I always describe Jesus coming to earth. It's like if you had the best house, the best clothes, everything was pressed every day, you lived in this beautiful place, it would be like you leaving all of that to go into the sludge of the sewer and hanging out with the rats. That's Jesus leaving his eternal kingdom to come to us. And he desired to do that because he doesn't want to see this. That is not his goal. Eternal punishment is not his goal. It's the result of actions by humans. And so when we're reading through this, we can't miss the love of Christ in all of this. But so, two of the three things that we talked about, right? So it's eternal punishment, and it has to be conscious, meaning you've got to know what's going on. Right? So we already covered the eternal punishment part, right? What about the conscious part? Okay? This is interesting. I found this really interesting as I was studying this. In Luke 15, you have three parables. The lost sheep, the lost coin, and the lost sons. There's two sons. They're both lost, just in different ways. We call the last one the prodigal son. There's actually two prodigals in that story. But only one of them came back. Anyways. What is the point of those parables? Something was lost. It was regained. And now everyone celebrates. That's the story in each of those. They were destroyed, unusable, right? What we've already talked about. And now they've been found. They're usable again. They have life. This is the point of those. They're parables. You know what a parable is? A parable is kind of like a fable in a sense, but it's basically just a short story with a purpose. But Jesus uses general archetypes. The Father. Whose Father? It's the Father, right? Son. Whose son? It's the son. Now, they might represent something, but it's just general things so that we can understand. The owner of the vineyard, right? It's just, who's the owner? It doesn't matter. It's just a general concept. That's what a parable does. Use general concepts to relay a message. A story, on the other hand, is an example from everyday life. So Jesus gives the parable. Here's lostness, what that looks like. And when you're found by God, he rejoices. That's the purpose of the parables. From those parables into chapter 16, we get a story about Lazarus. And there's a difference there. Here's the general teaching. Here's an example of that in action. And so when we get to Luke chapter 16, verses 19 through 31, you get this story. And we're not going to read the whole thing. So basically the story is there's a rich man and Lazarus. Both of them die. Lazarus goes to this place called Abraham's bosom, which is where the righteous go. The rich man goes into another place. It's never named, but it's the place of the wicked. And there's a chasm, but they can see and talk to each other. And so Jesus is telling this story, and it's a story, not a parable, because Jesus is very specific. It's this guy named Lazarus. And if you're following in Luke and in the Gospels, there's a guy named Lazarus. So what he's doing, he's saying, he's connecting the two. While Lazarus was dead, here's a story about his life. And so in this, you get the rich man, and he calls out to Abraham. And this is what Abraham replies with in verse 25. Child, Remember that you in your lifetime received good things, and Lazarus in like manner bad things. But now he is comforted here, and you are in anguish. Notice some things that Jesus says. Child, remember. This guy knows what's going on. He knows what's going on there. He's in anguish. And he remembers what happened before. Are we in consciousness after we die? Yes. There's consciousness after we die. And going back to the loss, what is the end result of the loss? It's anguish. Why? Because they are separated. And so it's like Jesus is saying, "This is people are lost, but when I find them, we rejoice over them, that they're here in eternal life. That is great stuff. You know what's not great? This. And here's a story about what actually happens. That this rich man is now in anguish for the rest of eternity. It's heartbreaking stuff. And so, all three. Conscious, eternal, punishment. It's all right there in the scriptures. So, to answer that, we get this. Jesus sort of gives us that clear picture that life, that in the life to come, we will be conscious. Whether in righteousness or in wickedness, we will be conscious. All right? So, first claim done. Man, how long was that? Right? It takes time. Deep thoughts take deep understanding. It takes time. The next claim, I think we got the next claim up there. Yep. The idea of eternal conscious torment came from Dante's Divine Comedy. Now, if you don't know Dante's Divine Comedy, what it is it's a story. It's really a jab at the Catholic Church at the time. And Dante is being brought through, and he's experiencing all these different levels. There's the levels of hell, and there's the levels of heaven. There's both in there. And so he's saying that that's where this idea of conscious torment, because in the nine circles of hell, you're being tormented based on your sin. And so he's saying that's where this idea comes from. But we already saw that it isn't, right? But here's the question. What if we're misinterpreting it, right? Like, we should always say, I want to be as faithful to the scriptures as possible. So how did the early church interpret what we just talked about? That's what we should say. And so let's go back to the early church. We call them the church fathers. It's just the apostles and then the next generation, basically. We call them church fathers, people that influence how we interpret scripture. And so I want to give you some of their writings, just real snippets. We can't go into all of them, but these are three. These are pretty early on. The first one is a guy by the name of Clement. Okay, he's Clement of Rome. He writes, I think they call it like Third Corinthians. He writes to the Corinthians at one point, but he writes this. This comes from his second letter. It's called Second Clement. It says this. But when they see how those who have sinned and who have denied Jesus by their words or by their deeds are punished with terrible torture and unquenchable fire, the righteous who have done good and who have endured tortures and have hated the luxuries of life will give glory to their God, saying, there shall be for him that has served God with all his, or there shall be hope for him who has served God with all his heart. That torture, unquenchable fire is really important. Ignatius of Antioch, writing about 10 years later, he writes this, a man becomes so foul with departure into unquenchable fire, and so will anyone who listens to him. Last one, this is Polycarp. Polycarp is considered a mentee of John the Apostle. He says this, fixing their minds on the grace of Christ, the martyrs despised worldly tortures and purchased eternal life with but a single hour. To them, the fire of their cruel torturers was cold. They kept before their eyes their escape from the eternal and unquenchable fire. So the early church interpreted what we had talked about today the same way. There is an eternal judgment of separation ahead for those who are wicked, those who have not come to Christ. So, these guys are writing 1,200 years later, or earlier than the Divine Comedy. Dante is writing 1,000 years or so after. This is important stuff, because where does this idea come from? It doesn't come from him. So again, the second claim there is false. So far, the two claims that we have seen in this video are false. Biblically speaking, historically speaking. So now let's go to the third claim, which is hell isn't a concept in the Bible. Now, in the verse that we said earlier, Matthew 10:28, it mentioned hell. And he's saying that's just a misinterpretation. That word isn't there. He says there's four words that are used in the Bible. Sheol, Hades, Gehenna, and Tartarus. Tartarus, we're not going to worry about, because it's not used. It's used, like he said, like one time. The other three are important, though. So let's talk about that. Sheol and Hades, they're basically the same concept. It's the land of the dead. So in Hebrew, they would use the word Sheol. Or Sheol, depending on, you know, if you want to say it right. Who wants to do that? So when you translate Hebrew into Greek, what are you going to use? You're going to use Hades. Because the idea of translations is this. You take a word from your language and you go, what's the closest I can get with that language to my word and the concept of my word? So the closest they could get from Sheol, from the Hebrew understanding of Sheol, which is just, it's a blanket place for anyone who dies. It's just a blanket. It's a, like where every dead person goes, righteous or unrighteous. We get a separation later on in that story with Lazarus, Abraham's bosom. But the word Sheol is just that blanketness. What's the closest we can do when we transfer into Greek? The answer is Hades. Okay. So now the question is, if we're going from Hebrew or Greek into English, what word should we use? What is the closest concept, right? Here's the insight. There isn't a concept like that in one word. We have to use at least two words. Underworld. Like that would be a good translation, underworld. But when you say underworld, what does that bring to mind? It might be underground, it might be hell. So it expands, so it's not the best word. So it's like, okay, so this is why, in fact, in some translations, they'll just leave it as Sheol. English translations, because there's not a real good translation word for us. So, what about Gehenna? So the story goes with Gehenna is that it's a valley outside of Jerusalem, that at one point there was a lot of sacrifices, a lot of human sacrifices there. There was judgment there, and eventually became a refuge. And they would do all these fires. The fires would constantly be burning because they're trying to burn up all the garbage. And that became the mindset of, where do the wicked go? They go to Gehenna, the place of judgment, the place of death, the place of eternal fire. We could say it kind of like, the concept would be kind of like this. You know that place up the road, almost you get to Parker before, you know, right before you turn at the light? There is a garbage dump out there. That is kind of the idea. All right? It's a little more, but that's kind of the idea. It's the garbage dump. What word in English carries with it the concept of wicked punishment in a bad place? That becomes the question. How do we translate words? So let me give you what's called the etymology of the word hell. Now, I'm not an etymologist, so I have to read this. Okay? So the word hell comes from the etymology. It's Northern European. So there's hella, there's helia, there's hell, there's hola, and there's halia, or something like that. These are all a concept that comes from a word of H-E-L, hell. And the concept is, it's an underworld location for the punishment of the wicked. What is Gehenna? It's a place where the wicked are punished. So when translating, what's the closest we can get from Gehenna to hell? That's why we use hell, because we do have a word that is close to that understanding. That's why we use hell. So why is it translated as hell? It's because that's the closest concept. Claim number three, there is no concept of hell in the Bible. Yes, there is. It's Gehenna. It's the same. All right? So there you go. So we just went through, what, anyone timed that? It was a while. You shouldn't be timing it. What's wrong with you? But it took us that much time to unpack all of what was said in 59 seconds. That's why I say it's TikTok theology. It's not real theology. It's the minute or less theology. One time I heard someone say it's bumper sticker theology. If you can put it on a bumper sticker, say it in three words, that's not real theology. That might be helpful to point to a concept, but to understand the concept, you need more time. There are people that spend their whole lives studying a portion of Scripture. Not the whole thing, just a portion, because there's so much there. I had a girl one time say to me, she was in eighth grade, and she was coming to the youth group. She was there in sixth grade and seventh grade. And in eighth grade, she stopped coming. She was coming to church, but she stopped coming to the youth group. And I said, so why aren't you coming to the youth group anymore? She goes, well, I already learned everything I need to know about the Bible. I'm like, wow, that's pretty good, because I've been studying this I've been studying this for about 12 years. I still don't know everything about the Bible. Like, I'm still learning new things. I'm still studying. It's like that thing where I said the lostness in Luke 15, and then that story. Like, I connected that through this. Like, I'm still learning. And so, but this is what we should be as believers. When we're challenged with something, we don't run and hide. We say, okay, if God is true, then I should not fear anything. I should be able to study this. And I will tell you, I've had people say, here's a contradiction in the Bible. And then they'll give me one. A while back, one was, I think it comes from Proverbs. I can't remember the exact location, but it says, in one verse it says, do not answer the fool as folly. And then the very next verse it says, answer the fool as folly. That's a contradiction. It's like, until you understand the Hebrew culture, and what they're saying is, in some circumstances, you answer the fool as folly. In other circumstances, you don't answer the fool as folly. You have to be a judge of the situation to know what to do. You have to know the distinction. That's the Hebrew understanding. That's why they put them back to back like that. But there's a lot of that stuff. So when we study Scripture and we start understanding not just what it says, but the context in which it was said, God's always right. And so we need to do this. So in 2 Corinthians 10:5, I think that's the next thing. Is that right? I'm on track?
Yep.
All right, that's weird. 2 Corinthians 10:5. Paul says this, we destroy arguments and every lofty opinion raised against the knowledge of Christ and take every thought captive to obey him. Why do we do this? It's not to win arguments. It's to point people to Jesus. That's what he says. We destroy arguments and every opinion raised to the knowledge of God and take every thought captive to obey Christ. We point back to Jesus. That's the purpose. And then in 1 Peter 3:15, this is where that apologia word comes from. But in your hearts, honor Christ, the Lord, as holy, always being prepared to make a defense to anyone who asks you for a reason for the hope that is in you, yet do it with gentleness and respect. How do we bring honor to Christ? We defend the faith. We study it. We don't back down. That honors Christ. And we do so in gentleness and respect. You might look at that guy and be like, man, he's a weird looking dude. So are you to some people. Right? We're all a little weird. That's why you're in quartzite. I mean, come on. Like, you wouldn't be weird in living in Quartzsite. You had to be a little off. And so that person needs Jesus. Just like our neighbor needs Jesus. Just like I need Jesus every day. The only difference between me, a saint, is Jesus. It's like this. I love the idea of this. We are all beggars looking for food. The difference is the Christian has found it. And now the job of that beggar is to show other beggars, here's the food. You know? That's the difference. And so, Jesus said it, and Paul said it. So Jesus said it in Matthew 24, Paul said it in 2 Timothy, that there would be teachers who will teach false doctrine. It's our job to say this is false. These are the reasons why. And let me point you back to Jesus. So my challenge for you is this. Two of the resources I used today were BibleGateway.com and BibleHub.com. These are resources I want to challenge you to familiarize yourself with, especially if you can. If you need to pick one of two, BibleHub.com. It's an easy one. Ken, who is back there, he does our prayer tree. He's like, you start going down that thing and you're there forever because it's so in-depth. You know, connecting words, it will give you that. It's a good resource. I want to challenge you to familiarize yourself with at least one of those. Because when it comes time and you got to go, oh, this word was brought up, how do I figure that out? You have two options. Do it yourself, which that's what you should, or go, hey, Jeremiah, can you do the work for me? And I'm going to go, no. Bible, go to BibleHub.com. You can do it. You got it. You have the Holy Spirit inside of you. You have the Word of God. You're good to go. Okay? So that's my first challenge. The second challenge, if you're like, man, I'm not good at technology. Okay, I got a challenge for you too. Pray for that individual. At some point, he says he has been traumatized by the church, so he's been hurt by the church. We need to be praying for him. And the 400, I don't know if I said this, over three social media sites, 400,000 people follow this guy. He is influencing I just didn't pick him out random. Like, that guy. He looks weird. No. Because he has 400,000 people listening to him. Pray for those people. Now that might be, that's just on his little thing, how many people subscribe. We need to be praying for those people too. Okay? So that's your challenge. If you can't do anything else, be in prayer. And have your heart break the way God's heart breaks for the lost. All right? Now we're going to go into communion the way that God broke for us to bring us into his kingdom. That's what remembering communion is. So I want to pray for us. Heavenly Father, thank you for today. Thank you that you've allowed us to be a part of your family through no work on our part. We didn't do anything. We just accepted it. We accepted free grace. And so, Lord, we thank you for that. In truth, we are no better than anyone else. The only difference is we accepted what you did. So, Father, if there's someone in here that doesn't know you, that you would either open them up to the moving of the Holy Spirit or start taking down that journey that leads to the cross. Because, Father, that's what we should want, is every person we know to kneel at the foot of the cross just like we do, to gain that eternal life. Not separated from you, but into eternal life with joy and peace and that love that you have for us. Father, I pray for this individual that they would know your love, not in a carnal way that seems like they are pursuing, but in the way that breaks through all veils, anything that would hide them from you. that they would know your pure love and that they would turn to you. And that through that testimony of turning, that those 400,000 people would hear a true gospel. Not the gospel of man, but the gospel of the Lord Jesus. So Lord, just thank you. As we move into communion, Lord, let us bow before you in it. In your son's name we pray. Amen. So if I could have the guys come on up for communion. We're going to start out with the bread. And then as it's being passed, if you would just hold the bread, and then we'll take it together. I think, Tony, would you step up? I don't know if you guys know this. That's Tony right there. He's your associate pastor. Yeah, you guys can start giving. Would you join us in song, though, as we sing to our Lord?
Sin to hide, but you have sent him from your side to walk upon this guilty sod and to become the Lamb of God. Your gift of love they crucified.
Things is Jesus descends to us. Thank you. Jesus descends to us, leaving that perfect eternal kingdom and breaks for us. Like that concept of a deity sacrificing it themselves for creation is nowhere in any religion. It's so unique that it begins to pop up 1,000 years later because the other religions go, our God's not like that. Let's make him like that. And they start incorporating the story of Jesus into their own deities because that's the desire of humanity, to know it's God. But Jesus is the only one who said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. Amen. And it's through the broken body on that cross. So let's go to the Father. Father, we thank you for the broken body of Jesus on the cross, because that should have been us paying our own sin, even though that wouldn't even cover the cost. But Jesus, you did it, willingly did it. You went before your own creation and allowed your creation to pin you to the cross in rebellion against their creator. And yet it was your plan. Out of your desire for the lost, out of your desire that we would not be separated, you broke your body for us, that we might not be broken in eternity. Thank you for the love you show for us. Moved by your Holy Spirit, that we might show that love to other people. We praise you in the name of Jesus. Amen. Mm-hmm. Let's take.
I want
They say it's a cup of suffering for Christ and a cup of blessing for anyone that would accept Jesus as their Savior. It's meant to remind us of the great love that covers us. Because from the very get-go, when in Genesis 3, when Adam and Eve, they sinned, and they were eternally separated from God, God stepped in and made the first sacrifice to clothe them. And from then on out, the concept of understanding that something must be sacrificed to clothe the nakedness of sin, we see that in the temple, only one person could go into the holies of holy. Only they were able to do that. Only they were able to sprinkle the blood on. Oh, we're all out, huh?
Yeah.
That's great. But I got you. Thank you. But what's great is God set up his own altar, the cross, and we can give that actually to Jody. We actually took communion this morning, so we're good. But Jody hasn't, so. So in God sets up his own sacrifice, his own altar, because we couldn't get into the altar that separated us. So he brings it out to us and sacrifices that we may be covered by that blood. And so when we're holding this cup, it's a cup of deep love, of deep sorrow, and a deep rejoicing for anyone who comes to know Jesus. So let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for doing the sacrifice, for doing everything needed to fix the relationship that you didn't break, that we broke. You loved us enough to not abandon us, not snap us out of existence, but to call to us, to bring us back to yourself, that we may know you in eternity. Jesus, without your blood, without your sacrifice, without your desire for us, none of this is possible. Our words would be empty and our hope would be futile. But because of your sacrifice, you rose from the dead. And our hope is in resurrection. Our hope is in your return. Lord, the way the world's going, it looks like it's getting closer and closer. So get your church going to share the gospel. So we praise you for the cup of blessing. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So we're in our second service, we take an offering. It's part of tradition. And it's a little easier than to say every week, hey, there's a box back there. So we're going to take an offering. And we haven't done this all summer. So I don't know what's going on. I know, but I was told, you're going to do this. So I only do things what I'm told. I learned that from my wife. All right. So, gentlemen, you're hanging me out here. Do I have the guys that are doing the offering to come on up? I got one. Do I hear two? No.
As
we take an offering, if this is your first time here, you don't need to give anything. The offering is to be a partner in the ministry here. And so we'd rather you learn about us and become part of our family, because our ministry here, we're called to the young people of this town, to the youth and the children. That's why we're founded, that's why we're here, and that's the only reason if God blesses us is because we're doing his work. So if you want to give, you can, but that's what you're giving towards. All right? So as we begin, you guys can pass it out. We're going to sing a song. How about that? All right? Do I got to pray? I got to pray, right?
Yeah.
Yes. Haven't done this all summer, people. All right, let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this offering. Lord, we are so thank you that we get to receive it to do your ministry. Lord, this is our prayer. You know you've put it on our hearts, so why am I telling you this? But Lord, if we ever get out of step with you, we don't deserve anything. So Lord, you can take it all away. So Lord, we are grateful that we can continue to do the ministry to our town, to the young people of this town. Lord, share the gospel with them through us, that you may build your kingdom. Don't build the Alliance Church. That's not our name. Our name is the church. We are yours. Lord, do with us as you will. In Jesus' name, amen. But would you sing with us this song? You might not know this song. If you don't know this song, it's probably new to you. But it is a gospel-centered song. All right, so here we go.
Darkness, we were waiting without hope, without light, till from heaven you came running. There was mercy in your eyes to fulfill the law and prophets. To a virgin came the word, from a throne of endless glory to a cradle in the dirt.
And
praise the Father. Behind me, the cross before me, the world behind me.
Get out there and share that word. All right? God bless you. Have a great week.
I said, oh, excuse me. Oh, I didn't.